Skipton lies on the Leeds and Liverpool Canal, nowadays more a place of recreation than an artery of commerce, and that goes for much of the surrounding countryside as well. To the north of Skipton is the Yorkshire Dales National Park, and to the south, the gentle hills, quiet places where people can escape from the pressures of every day and consider their lives. And this is a good time to be doing that, because this is Advent, and Advent marks the start of the church's year, the time when Christians prepare to celebrate the coming of Christ by looking into themselves, thinking in what ways they've gone wrong, and resolving to do better in future. And so tonight we're going to be looking past the friendly face of this peaceful country town, past the picture postcard castle, past the busy vitality of the market, to meet some ordinary people who've let change come into their lives. And it's here in Holy Trinity Parish Church that Christians from all over Skipton have come to sing their Advent songs of praise. Their first hymn, "Lo, He Comes with Clouds Descending." much of its history, the economy of Skipton was based on the sheep and cattle that grazed on the surrounding hills. So much so that the town's name comes from the Anglo-Saxon for sheep, and a fleece is the main symbol on the coat of arms. The Industrial Revolution brought change. Textile mills, rope making and tanning factories were built. The railway came. A new population of factory workers moved into the town, and the houses built for them scarred the Yorkshire countryside with the texture of the big city. But when those industrial workers looked up, away from their work and the dark streets, they could see and be refreshed by the clear beauty of nature in the hills above the town. And so our second hymn looks forward to the Messiah coming to sweep away the darkness by his shining example. O come, Emmanuel. When Patricia Redfern's second son, Adam, was born, there were problems.
Adam was born with club feet. In fact, the moment he was born, the nurses said, "Oh, he's got club feet," and I just felt utterly stunned. And then a week later, he was in hospital for a week for extensive treatment on his feet, and they found out he had a heart murmur. Then he was transferred to a hospital in London, and they told me exactly what was wrong with him. And they told me that he had an enlarged heart, a deflated lung, a blocked artery, and also a small hole in the heart. But to find where this hole was, they had to do a special test on him. And meanwhile, all the churches round about where we lived were praying for him. And I also had this deep assurance in my heart that everything was going to be all right. I can't explain it, but it was something really deep down inside. And I phoned on the Thursday evening and I spoke to the sister and I said, "How is he? How did the test go?" And she said, "There's nothing there." And I said, "You mean there's no hole in the heart?" She said, "Everything else has gone." And I went in on the Friday morning and there was the doctors all round his bed and they said, "Isn't it wonderful, Mrs. Redfern?" And you know, I was just absolutely taken aback, because though I believed with all my heart and I knew that he was going to be all right, when it happens to you, It's so marvellous, you know, it's really marvellous.
What was the reaction of all the other people who'd been praying with you?
Well, some of them accepted it. Others couldn't believe it. They said things like, oh, you know, isn't it marvellous what the surgeons can do? And I said, they haven't done anything. I said, they've just done tests on him. And they just couldn't accept it. And I felt very sad, really, because I just wanted them to share in the whole wonder of it, because it was so marvellous.
Tell me about the hymn that you've chosen.
The hymn that I've chosen is Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Mrs. Phyllis Burns runs a class in elementary English.
The headmaster of this school where the immigrants attend was very worried because the children were being called out consistently to go shopping or helping mother to go to the doctor's or shop because the mothers could not speak any English and could not understand. And so the children had to do the interpreting. This became rather a burden because these children were never in school. He was deeply concerned about this, and so with the management committee of the school, they got together and decided that it would be a good idea to have a class for the mothers. It was suggested that we should teach them in their homes, but we realized that the mothers never got out of their homes and never met, had the opportunity of meeting other people. And so we ran this class so that they could come out and get to know the teachers who were white people and also to encourage them to meet other people. And this has brought great joy to them. They love it. They don't like missing. They love to come and meet us. And so consequently, in the town, when they're about, people speak to them, and they go to the clinic, and they make friends there with the people who run the clinic.
Thank you. I will call the fire brigade for
you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
The whole atmosphere is one that they feel they belong to Skipton and are part of it. The hymn I've chosen is Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, O Lord, to Thee. We all have abilities to do something in some small way, whoever we are, and we can serve the community, we can help in so many ways to give cheer and joy and happiness.
Save my life, God, as it may be lost.
George Davies is a psychiatric nursing auxiliary at Airedale General Hospital. Like many of his patients, he's experienced great unhappiness.
I had really reached a point of rock bottom a number of years ago where I was really unhappy. I'd been dishonest in relationships and dishonest in my work. And I'd been brought to a point where I actually was really at that point of the lowest I could ever be.
And was it really a grim feeling?
It was, yes. I was really gripped by really self-hatred in some cases, yeah.
How did you break out of that mood?
Well, for the first time in my life, I really read my New Testament, and I read St. James's Epistle. And in it, the words, "the man who loves the world hates God," really leapt out at me. And I was faced with a picture of a road that forked ahead. The way I'd been going, which had led me to this place, I had a choice to follow, or go God's way. And I felt that was where I wanted to go, and I followed that route.
So what did you do then to follow this new road?
Well, I joined a community, a Christian community, running a centre, and that had its advantages because I was unable to get away with things. You can't when you're living and working with community. You are with them, and they will let you know if you're doing things that you shouldn't.
Anyway. What sort of work were you doing there?
Well, I worked washing dishes and cleaning floors and things. But I was a member of the community, one of many, I think.
There is a danger, isn't there, of smugness? I've got Jesus, I don't need anybody else.
Well, yes, but when you're actually aware that you are in community, you learn that you've got to be interdependent. You've got to be concerned for others and let them be concerned for you.
Tell me about the hymn that you've chosen.
On Jordan's Bank, it talks of Christ's coming, and particularly, as I'm in psychiatric nursing, coming to heal. And that's why I've chosen it.
Mrs. Yvonne Burton has seven children.
When Keith and I had had our first three daughters, we sadly lost our fourth baby. Four times in that same week, our attention was brought to the organisation Project Vietnam Orphans, and we decided to write to the organisation explaining what had happened to us and asking if they felt that it was right for us to adopt a Vietnamese child. 21 months later, Daniel came to live with us.
Will you say grace, please?
Dear Lord Jesus, thank this lovely tea. Amen.
Well, in January of 1975, we applied to the same organisation, asking if we could adopt another little boy. And 3 months later, Andrew came to England. Some people think that it's harmful to bring children out of one culture into the West. And I would say that my boys were now more Yorkshire boys than Vietnamese boys. But I don't see people in that way. I just see people as individuals God made in his own image, and he loves them.
And if there's a child there without the love of a mother or a father and deprived, I think it's more important that that child should know what love is in a home than be kept where he is and perhaps put into a children's home or left to be a street boy. The song I've chosen is A Future and a Hope. This is a song about the third world based on a verse in Jeremiah, explaining that there's no future, no hope for people who are underprivileged or refugees or living in the third world unless we have concern and compassion and help in practical ways.
Alan Ripley has been a postman for 16 years. The thing that strikes me straight away when I meet you is what a cheerful person you are. Have you always been cheerful?
Well, no, because my childhood wasn't a particularly cheerful one. I caught TB when I was 2.5 and spent the rest of the 7 years nearly in hospital, in a sanatorium at Sheffield. And my parents were only allowed to visit me once a month on a Sunday afternoon for a couple of hours.
When you grew up, among many other things, you became at one time a missionary, didn't you?
Yes, that's right. I worked for the Baptist Missionary Society and I went out to Congo, as it was then, Zaire now, and worked amongst refugees which were coming over from Angola. And I stayed there for 2 years.
Then you came back again. Did you not want to go back to Angola?
Well, no, because when I came home, I got married. And simply because I knew how important it was to have my family around me. The children were young and growing up, and I wanted to be with them, not as it had been in my childhood. So we stayed at home.
Are you branch secretary of the Post Office Workers Union? What does a branch secretary do?
Well, we're not involved as branch secretaries at a local level with the actual pay or conditions of work as such. Our job really is to look after the members within the branch, to negotiate possibly between the postmaster and the members within the branch, and to try to make their job a little easier.
So this will fit in fairly well with your Christian principles?
Oh, yes, because the unions began from Christian principles, and it fits in very well today, yes.
Well, so did the church. But do you feel that the church and unions have stuck to those principles quite as they should?
Unfortunately, they haven't. You could give a good parallel between the two, in so much that the larger unions look after themselves these days, as the larger churches look after themselves to some extent. And it would be nice if they could all come together and look after each other, as we are all trying to work for better conditions for all workers, for all men.
Tell me about the hymn that you've chosen.
Well, I've chosen Hark the Glad Sound, because it is an Advent hymn looking forward to Christmas, which is a happy time. And we, as a family, enjoy it, and I hope that families all throughout the country will enjoy it as we do.
Almighty God, give us grace that we may cast away the works of darkness and put upon us the armor of light, now in the time of this mortal life in which thy Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that at the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the quick and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. Now we all join together in the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all evermore.